We are speaking now today on a topic that has already been on the agenda of the Internet Governance Forum since 2007, at least as I know, which is abuse and sexual exploitation of children on the internet. But today we want to put a special focus on the so-called gray areas, which would mean we would like to talk with you about what is sexual exploitation, what is abuse, beyond what has been called previously so-called child pornography. And there are many gray areas around that. And my colleague Gitte Jacobsen from Save the Children Denmark will go more in detail into that topic. So first let me introduce you to the speakers, and I begin on my right side, which is Marie-Laure Lemineur from ECPAT International. Then we have Marco Pancini from Google. We have Gregory Mounier from the European Cybercrime Center at Europol. Natasha Jackson representing the GSMA, the Mobile Operator Association, and Amy Crocker from the InHope Foundation. And we will explain a little bit more what the role of these organizations, all the organizations, is in combating child sexual abuse. I would like to introduce you to the network No Gray Areas, which was set up in Germany 1 year ago, and you all have the reports on your table, so if you would like to get more information, it's in the reports that are spread out. We have some slides to show you just shortly to introduce you to the work of the network. And when we are talking about depictions of abuse and sexual exploitation of children in the gray area, these images are characterized by mostly international dissemination, why it's so important that we are talking today here at the Internet Governance Forum about the issue. They are easily to be found and to access, and it depends on national legislation whether they are considered illegal or not, so we will hear more about that later on. When we started the network in Germany, we had the objective to develop an international strategy to combat this type of depictions of images of abuse and sexual exploitations. We have agreements with platform providers so far with Google, and Marco, I think you will tell us a little bit more what Google is doing in the network. And we have agreements with the hotlines operating in Germany, how they deal when they get reports on this gray area imagery. And that is very, very important to understand that the hotlines take reports from the people out there. And most of the people that report that they have found something that they find disturbing, that is of concern to them, they would not know if this is really illegal material or if it's just disturbing to them. So the hotlines already get the reports on the gray area imagery and they deal with that, and that's the role they have in the network No Gray Areas. So just to make you understand that we are talking about images, we have some criteria already set to understand what images we are talking about. And the images could be in the gray area because the depiction itself is harmful to the children that is shown on the image. But in addition, it could also be harmful to children that are confronted with these images, for example, in the process of grooming. And then what is really important to mention is that also the context of the provision of these images is very important. It could be the amount of images that are shown in a certain area on a website or in a forum, and it could also be the area where the images are shown. When it's a website where other pornographic content is shown and then the images of the children are put in there, it could also be gray area imagery. And then, and that is also important, it could be just sexualization by the comments that are put to innocent images that show children, but then they are commented on by people who just might be telling what they would like to do with these children that are depicted on the images. And we know it's very difficult to assess the context of the image and the context of the provision of the image. But we will come to that point later when the colleague from the German Institute of Artificial Intelligence will tell us about the methodologies, how the image itself and the context that it's provided in will help to understand whether it's gray area imagery. So the network No Gray Areas that has been working for 1 year now in Germany is built on three pillars. It's on the one hand a competence center that sets up all the knowledge that is around the images, how to understand which search terms are used by perpetrators to get access to the images. Then we have the platform providers, but I'm very happy to have Google on board of the project. We are also talking to other platform providers like Facebook, but Twitter, so far they did not have joined the network. And then, as mentioned before, we have the hotlines that have a very important role in taking the reports and then considering, assessing, and deciding what they can do on the images, either illegal or not illegal. So far, I would leave it to that point, just to give you a short understanding what the network No Gray Areas is doing. And now I would like to hand over to our first remote speaker, which is Gitte Jacobsen from the Save the Children Denmark. And she is remotely here, and we have her presentation. So can you put up the next presentation, please, and then let us hear what Gitte has to explain with her presentation. Thank you. Okay, Gitte, can you hear us? We don't have your voice on the loudspeaker, but I heard you faintly. We can't hear her. It should come from there. Yes. Could someone tell her to stop? Because she's speaking and we don't hear her. We were so much forced to have remote participation in speakers, so I hope that the technology will help us to make it working. Okay, the technicians are... Do you hear it on the...
Yeah, but it could be next door.
Oh, okay. She was... Just speak on. Go on, please.
On the area, you need to change the slide, please. Yes, that would be the happy children. Stop there. Thank you. So we're looking at the illegal content on the one side, knowing that what we have there is pretty clear and simple for us to understand. Next slide. Please move on. Can I do that? Myself. So on the one hand, we have, this is going too fast. Can I do anything on the remote here? No. Okay, it's a little problem with the slides. You're moving too fast for me. Anyway, I'll just go by my own slides here. I'll see if you can follow along. We have on the one hand, the illegal content. We do not want to show you any of that. We are not allowed to. We don't want to. In the middle, we have like the gray area. So between the normal growing up, the normal images, any image of any child, and then the illegal, we have what we call images in the gray area. And we did a report on that in Denmark 2 years ago, looking at probably around 20,000 images, because we do run a hotline looking at illegal material, reporting to police, international network, everything about that. But we found that a lot of images were like modeling images. And if you have that one slide showing the front page of the report, you also have one example of an image in the gray area, which is obviously gray area, because in Denmark, this would not be illegal. In some countries, it would be. But what you have when you look at images in the gray area, and we're moving to that slide with the black and white image, and the text saying the sexual or erotic nature of the images lies both in the objective qualities of the material itself and in the mind of the collector. And that is an old quote and an old, very old image. But really what it's saying is that you could have images that are in the gray area or any image exploiting children in a context that is highly sexualized. So let me give you the definition that we work with on images in the gray area. If you have that on the screen now, my slide number 7. Images in the gray area are still or moving images of children's bodies where the photographer's staging of the child and or the use of the material in an erotic or otherwise sexualized context gives grounds to presume that the purpose of the recording or the display is to satisfy a sexual interest in children. This is the definition that we came up with. So we're talking about images of children's bodies and the way that it is being exposed. I will give you a few examples of that kind of images in a few minutes. We have a commercial aspect in this that is very important for us to highlight as well. That is the next slide. Financial profit made from sexual exploitation of a child, trafficking children for sex, sex tourism. Also, the latest, what comes up is the live cam digital sex tourism. You don't even have to travel anymore. Just sit down behind your computer, order sexual abuse of children. Child prostitution, and then the production and sale of child abuse images, including sale or advertising of pornographic and other types of websites with child sexual abuse material. Moving on to the next slide is a bit tricky for you if you do it there, because several images will appear once you click through it. So what you have is, on the one hand, we have the illegal material. Really, it's based on the Taylor and Quayle categories 1 through 10, and you can read about that in the report if you don't know that yet. But you have basically from normal to the normal images, any image of any child in any circumstance that you would just show to anyone. And then all the way through to the most gross assault, sadistic bestiality images. And all what is marked there in the red illegal is illegal content. That is pretty obvious what that is. And then you have on the left-hand side the images of the happy child, the nudism and art, and then the voyeuristic, any image that an adult with sexual interest in children could have to look at for their own benefit of sexual interest. In between, we have the posing and erotic posing. And if you click through, you will see the images appear, and now should be a yellow circle on posing, erotic posing. And in that is where you find the images in the gray area. And that would be the images itself. They are there, and I'll show you a few examples. But really, we've put gray area from the normal to erotic posing because that is about the context. So gray area could also be how it is being exploited, the images of the children. The next slide gives you a lot of details on the research we did. You can have a look at that later, but basically it's saying that in some image, some of the URLs, some of the websites, you find one image, but in a lot of them you find more than 100 images. When you scroll down, it just keeps coming up loads and loads of images. Children, boys and girls, age group, interestingly, 9 through 12 years old, most of these images show children in that age group. So we had the illegal, if you scroll down now, the illegal content on the one hand, and then comes again the report, and three images from the report gives you an idea of what kind of images are we looking at. And these are the definitely close, very obvious staging of children as models. These images would not be illegal in Denmark, maybe in some other countries. It could be one of them, a lot of girls in gym suits, but really the way they are being exposed and the way they pose is coming closer to the erotic posing. And the next image actually gives you an example of even more of this kind of images. I have highlighted one image of a boy and girl that could be really just a sister and brother, but it's put in a context of highly sexualized images. But on the left side of this, if you have the same slide in front of you that I have now for my computer, you have an example of hundreds of images, just that narrow sort of band with loads of images coming down. The next image I want to show you is more specific on the erotic posing and the absolutely gray area exploitation. Now, for some of you, the next slide will be illegal images, but still there are children that are being most likely commercial exploitation of children. I've covered part of the image on the right there. You see it in front of you. But really, if I took away that gray cover, that is the one image. It's a girl, but you know what she's dressed like. On the left image, you see another image that could be just any ordinary image of a girl, but the context with that little penis drawing in it definitely gives gray area. This is just one small example of the most easiest, you could say, or the most simple example of gray area that are much more explicit. So coming to a closure, next slide, images in the gray area is definitely exploitation of the child. And did the child give his or her consent to the photographer? I don't think so. Did the child give permission to the distribution? They probably didn't even know that this was about to happen, that it would be distributed. And did the parents give their consent is the question we can ask. And maybe, yes, they did, because they also got money from it. Or maybe they were forced into it. Maybe they sold their child. We don't know that. Probably a lot of grooming going on. But fact is that it could be any image of any child copied from any web page that is brought in, is displayed in a gray area context, sexual-like context. Or it could be an image that is definitely made for that purpose. So just stating again the definition of the images in the gray area, we are not talking about the obvious illegal. We are not, in a sense, talking about the normal any picture of any child, but the gray area that is there in between this. So we have images in the gray area still, or moving images of children's bodies where the photographer's staging of the child and or the use of the material in an erotic or otherwise sexualized context give grounds to presume that the purpose of the recording or display is to satisfy a sexual interest in the children. So just the next slide to end at least on a happy note with the happy smiling children, because that's what it's supposed to be. But just bear in mind that this could also be images brought in a sexualized context and thereby become in its own way a gray area. Last slide is just saying stop the images in the gray area. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Gitte, for describing what we are talking about now in the next 60 minutes. And I would like to ask the floor, has anybody a direct question to our colleague Gitte about what she was talking about? If that's not the case, then due to the time, I would say we move directly forward, because the last question was by Gitte, what could we do about that phenomenon? And that would also mean understanding the concepts, understanding what industry can do, and especially what industry can do also on a voluntary basis, because we are not, as Gitte has explained before, speaking only about illegal content. And I give the floor to Marco Pancini. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Jutta. Let me introduce myself. I'm Marco Pancini from the Google office in Brussels. I'm dealing together with my colleagues on this issue since a few years now. And it's great to be at the IGF, where we can really have a discussion on this kind of issues on a multi-stakeholder level. So really bringing together all the different actors. One problem that sometimes we have in Brussels is that these conversations are happening between in a multilateral way, only between different two kind of stakeholders, the industry, the civil society, but it's very hard to get on in the same room all the different parties involved, including also the law enforcement, including the experts. So that's a great opportunity. And actually, we should try to think how we can replicate the same approach in Brussels. So very quickly, let me go into our approach to this very terrible issue, and we are very committed in trying to fight against any kind of abuse of these kind of images online. I will drive you through our commitment and our approach on this issue, in particular what are our reporting and removal tools, and then an update on the next challenges that we are trying to face. In terms of Google commitments, we are talking about hundreds of people working on child protection across all the different departments at Google, so legal, policy enforcement, but in particular engineering, because for a technological company like Google, the answer is first a technological answer to this problem, which means that it's 16 plus teams across all our structure, and which means also a strong investment in supporting the child protection NGOs in fighting against this phenomenon. We are talking about globally $24 million in the last year. Our approach is based on three pillars. The first pillar is remove child abuse imagery and report abuse as soon as we know about this kind of content. The second approach is invest in the best technology to proactively detect this kind of content. And the third pillar is to work together with the industry and the law enforcement and the NGOs in order to make sure that we also keep pace with the development of the criminal organization that try to exploit this kind of content. So let me focus for a second on the removal aspect. So I don't have to mention that our policies are absolutely in line with European laws, so we don't accept on any of our platform this kind of content, and that's with no gray area. It's across all the different platforms and in a very strong way, which goes sometimes also beyond what is legal or not legal in some jurisdiction, as we heard. In terms of proactive removal process, we have a very streamlined process where we receive a flag both from users that are on our platforms, like YouTube, for example, may find something that is not appropriate and then can report this to us, but also, and that's very, very, very important, through NGOs. And for NGOs, for example, on YouTube, we have a specific program called YouTube Trusted Flaggers that allow them to have a direct contact with our team and report in a very quick way any kind of illegal content that they may find. And we are working with the Internet Watch Foundation, we are working with the NICMEC, we are working with FSM, and with the other NGOs. All the content that they report to us also is hashtagged, and then I'll go more in the detail of this. But basically, we built together with all these partner a database or well-known image of child abuse material images, and we tagged. We added to this image a digital tag, which make us possible to identify when the same image is uploaded on one of our platforms, and therefore being able to avoid that the same image goes back online. So again, it's not just receiving and be very prompt to react to the flags and the removals requests that we are receiving both from users and from NGOs, but it is also empowering a specific technology in order to make sure that the same image or the same content cannot go up online again. The user report can come to us in all different ways. We really want to make sure that we put removal tools very near to the content, and so these happen across all the different services that we provide. In particular, for example, we have the possibility to report content on different products through our help centers, and then in YouTube you will find always near to every and each video a tool that allow you to report content that you think it's not appropriate. So what happens when we receive, again, let me summarize what happens when we receive a removal request. Our team is review this removal request, every of them, then we take action again against the content when it's child abuse content, and then we also report this content to NCMEC automatically in order to make sure that there is the possibility to make investigation against the content, against the person that has uploaded the content. Let me also focus for a second on our action technology. This hashing technology is very powerful because it's not only about, as I say, the content that we receive and the notice that we receive from our user, from our NGO, but also taking consideration the database of the NCMEC previously reported images. So it's really effective tool. And the two effects of these is to prevent the redistribution of known images and to report also to make sure that we can follow up with the law enforcement on the investigation against the individual who also trying to share these known images as well. There is a recent case in Germany about that, and that's actually another very important tool. And we also have a regular match and sharing of information with other hashtag technology like PhotoDNA, for example, which shows that how the industry is working together on that. Let me now move for a second on what we are doing on search. Quickly, but it's very, very important because search is actually the core of Google services. So not also taking in consideration this important dimension will not be possible for a company like Google. We started to work in particular with the UK government on this, but now we are expanding this across all the different platforms in Europe and elsewhere. And elsewhere, again, that's very important. And our approach on search is based on different tools that we are applying. First is the warning ads. So when we identified more or less 1,000 keywords terms that are related to child abuse material or to dangerous activities in this area, and every time these keywords are inputted in our search engine, we provide a specific warning ads informing the person that is making this search that the content that is searching for is illegal, the activity of searching and disseminating this kind of content is illegal, and also we provide links to support to NGOs that can support this person in curing and in affording their problem if there is a problem with the child abuse material. So again, that's the first The first approach is making sure that every time someone is searching for these specific keywords, this person receive a clear notice that the activity is illegal and there is a way to help him in going in trying to get over these illegal activities. Second, we provide also removal notification. So in case someone that is looking for a specific link and this link was removed because it was notified by us, by NGOs, by law enforcement, we clearly state in the search page that this link was removed because the content was illegal, and again there is a way to learn more through our partners and different sources. So this happens also for link, specific link to child abuse material. And the third tool that we implemented, and we think this is actually very, very powerful, is to work together with our engineers that are working on search quality to make sure that all are related, and so we're talking about the gray area, all the related search on child abuse material are demoted on Google. Therefore, does not come on top of the search results. And that's again to make sure that we are addressing not just the content that is illegal, but also the content that we don't think we want to treat this content as much as we treat the same for very, very bad stuff online, like for example malware or other illegal activities, and so we demote these results, and the result that we are having actually is great. We had a reduction of 8 times of traffic on these pages that we targeted by demoting them. So it's actually today more difficult for someone who is not clearly looking for this kind of content to end up in these pages. And that's also, for example, had an impact on the number of notices that we are receiving, which is, you know, it's actually positive. All this to say that is a combination of tools and approach that we need to put in place. But on top of all of these tools, I think the technological answer to try to solve this problem is still very, very important, and is still where a company like Google has to focus, which means that this is not a deal done. There are plenty of things that can be done, but through the collaboration with NGOs, through the collaboration with law enforcement, I think and trust that we can really provide a strong answer against this terrible issue.
Thank you very much, Marco Pancini. This was not only the industry perspective, I would say, but it was really what industry can do about the phenomenon. So thank you very much for explaining this. Natasha, would you like to comment on the industry perspective as well from your point of view? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm Natasha Jackson from the GSMA, which is the International Association of Mobile Phone Operators. So the 850 or so mobile operators around the world are our members. And we took action against child sexual abuse content a number of years ago. I think it was probably 5 years ago now, when we launched a voluntary initiative in the association called the Mobile Alliance Against Child Sexual Abuse Content. As I said, it's a voluntary initiative, and it's focused specifically on the issue of child sexual abuse content. It was actually discussed and agreed at board level, where operators were absolutely adamant that their networks really shouldn't be abused by people who are looking to exploit children online. And as members of the alliance, the operators who join take very sort of strong commitments to undertake specific actions. Now, the first action they do is to have hotline reporting mechanisms. So they will work with hotlines in their countries or international ones where they don't exist to make sure that their customers can easily report any incidences of child sexual abuse content that they come across. And then secondly, they make sure that their own house, they sort of have their own house in order. So to make sure that they have notice and takedown processes enabled within their organization to rapidly remove any content that they may find. And there's also terms and conditions and acceptable use policies, which will talk about this illegal content in order to reserve right to take action, and other sort of examples of internal processes reflect very much the sort of knowledge that repeat viewing of images is also harmful. And so there are processes to make sure that any employees viewing of any of those images, whether it's through a report from a customer, is minimized or tried to avoid at all, and that they are always passed on to a hotline so that the appropriate agencies can assess and view them. So there is absolutely no assessment of any images or viewing of that as part of the process within the organizations. And the third commitment is to take technical, undertake technical mechanisms to prevent access to this content. And once again, this is a really important point and very different from content companies, Google and others who host content. This is where the operators, of course, will not interfere with communications, and there are regulations around what they are allowed to do. You know, they are access providers, not content hosters. So they will implement technical measures to restrict access to this illegal content, but they do it on the basis of a list that's provided to them. So that list could be from an appropriate agency in their country, that may be law enforcement, and it may be, depending on the country, it could vary. They will take that list, they won't see that list, they will take it and they will implement mechanisms. So very importantly, they don't make a decision on the content themselves, and that's a really important principle for access providers. If a mobile operator does do content hosting, that's a different issue, but in most cases, we're not talking about that. So for us, whilst we very much support this area and recognize the sort of impacts and the need to protect children, the line around what is legal and what is illegal is quite firm, and it makes it difficult for us. Obviously, if there are countries where some of the posing images that we saw earlier, or the staged ones, are illegal, they went onto the list. For instance, if it were illegal in Denmark and it was on a police list, then that would be the access to that would be restricted for mobile networks. But it is through those lists that we need some legal clarity on what's that. The lists that the alliance members that we have use is only on child sexual abuse content. And in many cases, they take either a local list, if that's not in place, one from the Internet Watch Foundation, or perhaps from Interpol. And so from our perspective, we have an additional objective of making sure that we look always at what are the future issues that are coming our way and how can we help collaborate with all the stakeholders. So we look at issues also like mobile payments. So if mobile payments are part of the mechanism by which people are getting access to these catalogs of people posing, then that's something that we will look at as well. But really, we would encourage international debate on this. The more people understand it, the more important it is, and the more we can get legal clarity on these images, then they will just fall straight into under the existing commitments of the operators.
Thank you very much, Natasha, for your comments and for explaining a little bit more what the role of the mobile access providers could be. And I'm really grateful that you mentioned also the mobile payments, because we will come to that point later on, talking about what payment, what money is in there, what financial interest is there, or commercial interests. At this point of time, we also want to look at what can technology really do. Marco Pancini has already explained with Google how Google employs technology to detect and to remove such type of content. And as I had mentioned before, the context of the images, the provision of the images, and also comments, that means text, matters when it comes to categorize whether it's gray area imagery or not. And we have to have a look at new technologies to better understand and to help categorize the huge amount of images that are around there. And the research colleagues from the German Research Institute and on artificial intelligence are collaborating with us in the project network No Gray Areas, and Christian Schulze from the German Research Institute on Artificial Intelligence will now present what they are doing, what technologies there are already in use, and what they are trying to find out how the context could be more exactly categorized. So, do we have Christian on WebEx now? Because he's also a remote speaker to us today. I hope the technology will work. We have the slides already there. Christian, are you there? Seems to need, we need to have some patience, but maybe you have some questions in between that we could answer right now. He's okay, but we don't hear him. Okay, great. Great, hello. You just should just start, and I will go on with your slides, Christian.
Can you get up the slides?
You should just start. We have a problem statement slide now.
So there are multiple ways for perpetrators to seek and find illegal contents on the web, searching different sites, forums, blogs, social media channels as well, for not only the content itself, but also for the pointers to that content. In this case, usually a specific vocabulary containing a lot of abbreviations is utilized, additional to that, the vocabulary might change over time as law enforcement gains awareness and is able to take down these offers. Trends within communities regarding this vocabulary. This all turns out to become a problem of natural language processing from a technical point of view, where opinions and sentiment from these texts is supposed to be drawn. And this all requires a deep understanding of how language works, which is technically still posing a big problem. Next slide, please. One way of tackling this issue would be the so-called multimedia opinion mining, a topic where the DFKI is taking a close look into. Drawing the opinion of text is, as said before, a specific natural language processing problem. And we need to understand the sentiments of the text on one hand, also in order to make a decision what this text is targeting. We need to get an insight into how text is being used by people. This is all trying to aim for analyzing search terms and search phrases in order to prevent showing results that might be available on the web. In order to do so, we can go and analyze a bunch of text documents that are possibly provided by a search engine given a certain query. The text drawn from these documents can be turned into descriptive features. For text, this is particularly term frequency or the occurrence of certain words in amounts, so-called n-grams. And these resulting features can then be used to train particular classifiers for detecting particular search phrases or queries. So due to recent developments in this field, it is not only possible to analyze the sentiment from text, but also take the other modalities like images and videos into account. These might be linked to the documents we find given our query, or they might even be embedded. And with respect to the whole posing image problem, from the legal point of view, the legal nature of the imagery is often defined by the context they appear in, which in this case would refer to the text surrounding a particular image or maybe a video. So in order to do so, some things are needed which actually allow to describe the visual or even audible content by textual description, or to understand what's from a technical point of view, what's visible in the images and videos. A major step forward towards being able to do this are these novel deep learning techniques that are currently under heavy research in the community worldwide, which seem to allow to do exactly that. So the next slide. So this is basically a system sketch how to analyze search phrases for the aim of illegal content or finding illegal content. So what can be done is to actually pass on the search phrase to a search engine, which will sort of query itself different channels, social media, blogs, and other sources within the internet, which will result in a set of documents, images, and videos. And given feature extractors that build up on deep learning, for instance, the deep sentibank approach that is being developed by OpenAI, we are able to generate the necessary features for all these modalities, and these itself will be put into separate classifiers for text, visual information, and audible information, which then in turn will give a possibility to decide whether a particular search phrase or any text that is passed on to the search engine aims to find illegal or non-illegal content, which is basically the arrow going back to the search phrase, and we are able to decide in between whether this is an acceptable phrase or not. So this would basically already conclude the technical aspect. So I want to mention another development. Sort of just yesterday there was a video conference with some people from Google in Zurich. So people from the Safer Search and YouTube as well, which are highly interested in technologies for classifying images and videos for illegal content, which has been developed previously at DFKI, and which is able to detect explicit content so far, but given appropriate training data in the area of posing images, these technical solutions can also be extended towards detecting those kind of illegal content on the web, And by that, if deployed in the platform hosters, basically, they would allow to prevent the distribution, the finding of such material as well. So
thanks a lot, Christian. Yeah. I think we are running a little bit out of time. So there might be questions to this highly technological explanations you've already given.
I thought
it was very useful that you made the link between the work that you're doing, trying to analyze the search terms that are in use, because this is a precondition to the efficiency of the mechanisms that are employed by Google, because this warning ads, the splash screen, should show up when a certain search term that is previously categorized as being typical for maybe a perpetrator. So it's built on the relationship between both. So are there any questions from the room regarding these technical aspects? I see someone. You need to come over to the microphone that we hear you. Could you please introduce yourself?
It's on. Sorry, I didn't go into great length into explaining how they can look at phrases, meaning and interpretation of algorithms, what the meaning is, but the context, that's another thing. Telecommunications companies could have the initiatives voluntarily on how to stop this kind of content online, that is good. So technical people can go into great detail into trying to show what they are doing, and it's welcome. And law enforcement could come in and say how it's your duty to protect children. And so our governments say they are all to ensure children are protected. But I want to actually pose a different question. Is it the role of government to raise children? Because I want to ask that question by posing that there is a missing player in this whole debate. And that is the parent. At the end of the day, it's the parent who has a duty to raise their child. Now we can look for support from technical government and everybody else. But at the end of the day, let's not forget that the primary role of raising the children is the government. Semantics and all other things we'll do. At the end of the day, they are useless. If the parent is not empowered. So I think the missing voice in this conversation is what should be amplified. That's the role of civil society. And I'm happy to see Google saying how they have been involving NGOs, because this is a free speech issue. It's censorship of content online. And if we allow government or we allow companies to censor content online in the name of protecting children, there is a bigger issue. So what we must be doing is that the panel must have more of civil society that advocates for free speech, so that the name of children protection is not used to censor the internet. So I said I want to welcome everybody's intervention, including technical, but let's not forget whose role it is to actually protect the children. And in the interest of disclosure, I'm implementing Web Rangers Kenya, which is a Google-supported child online protection. So I do know the issues, and I'm from the civil society. Thank you.
For this statement, and I think we will get back to this statement when we have the debate at the end of the round, because it's a big issue talking about education of children, and it's also, there is the word saying that you need not only parents but the whole village to raise a child, and we are the whole village that have the purpose to protect children on the internet. And we will go back to that afterwards. I would now like to turn to the commercial aspects of the phenomenon that had already been mentioned. And I'm happy to have Gregory Monnier from the European Cybercrime Center in Den Haag. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jutta. Good morning, everyone. So I'm from the European Cybercrime Center, which is one of the units of Europol, which is the European Law Enforcement Agency. Just a few words about Europol. We don't have any executive powers. We support the 28 EU member states' law enforcement authorities to tackle organized crime, terrorism, and child sexual abuse online and elsewhere. In terms of child sexual abuse and exploitations, we have a team of about 15 specialists and criminal analysts working full-time on that issue. We are working on the basis of criminal information that are sent by our law enforcement agencies around Europe and beyond. Actually, we work very closely with the FBI, with the US ICE, the Australian Federal Police, New Zealand, etc. And we are focusing on any forms of criminal behavior against children. On the specific aspect of criminal distribution, commercial distributions of child abuse material, we are part of the European Financial Coalition, which is a broad multi-stakeholder coalition, including technical actors, NGOs like Hinhope, Internet Watch Foundations, Google, and a number of other partners. We've just recently issued a strategic report on commercial exploitations of children online, and I really invite you to have a look on our website to read the report. The first point I want to make is really about the volume of child abuse material that we can find online. I mean, it's really it's enormous. It's really huge. We have so those 20 or 15 specialists that are working on that field are working on about 20 ongoing international major operation. We had several successes like Downfall recently on peer-to-peer networks, but still the amount of information we're talking about is really, really big. About 2-3 years ago, one of our law enforcement agency partner mentioned that in one of the biggest EU member states, their estimation was that more than 50,000 people were involved in exchanging and sharing child abuse material online. And every time we do an operation, we get more new, fresh material, much more than we can process, actually. And that's, I want to really stress that, the limited resources of the law enforcement community to target these type of horrific crimes, which leads us, of course, to prioritize our targets. We are going after the biggest administrators of the biggest forum. We're going after the most active criminals. And of course, we can't tackle everything. So, which leads me to the point of the gray area. From a purely operational and police perspective, the gray area is important, of course, but because of the prioritization we have to do, we're going after all the child abuse material. Of course, it's down to the member states at the end when we after the analysis, then we provide them targets and we say, okay, in your member state, in your country, you have 3,000 targets that are active on that forum, so please investigate, please arrest them. And then it's down to the member state to say, well, actually, this is borderline according to our national legislations. So, of course, we support very much the initiative of Germany, for instance, to have made amendment to their criminal penal codes to explicitly draw the lines and what is child abuse material. And we would like to see something like that at European level, because, of course, we would catch more people. But again, my point is, like Marco said, and also Natasha, from the operational and police perspective, the grey area is, there's no grey area, it's either illegal or not, and we're going after everyone. Now I was invited to focus on the various payment measures and methods that are used to distribute commercial child abuse material. I think from that perspective, there are two principles. The first one is those offenders that are involved in that type of crimes are extremely IT savvy. We see that in that particular community of criminals, they're using cutting-edge encryption technologies. They're using all the new materials and technology and methods that they can obfuscate their activities online. And they're also very, very concerned about anonymity and their security. So whenever they have to use payment methods, they will naturally go towards alternative payment methods, that's what we call them. So that means money transfers, digital wallets, and virtual currencies. The second principle is that it really depends on the modus operandi. If you take, for instance, the booming trend currently, which is web live streaming of abuse online, then you will see that they're using money transfers because it's just more convenient. Money transfers companies have bureaus all around the world, in particular in South Asia and in Africa and everywhere the crime tend to take place more often. And so they will use that because it's convenient. But when we talk about darknet or online or a hacked website and so on, then they might be using more virtual currencies. That's also the second principle. But overall, there is a massive trend from a shift or migration from traditional payment methods like credit card payment to these alternative payment methods because of a robust law enforcement reaction, but also because the very good work that the private sector is doing in either in the financial and banking sector, the payment methods and the service electronic service providers such as Google and so on. Also, they're shifting to these alternative payment methods because it's less traceable, and for them it means it's less vulnerable and it provides more anonymity. In terms of volume and trying to give a quantitative assessment, it's very difficult, but on the basis of information we receive from HINOP and Internet Watch Foundations, our analysts have so analyzed information, and we came up with a very indicative assessment. So I think it's about 50% of, for instance, website URLs that are providing commercial child abuse material that are using money transfers, so 50% about money transfers. 30% are still using credit cards transfer, and then 20% digital wallets and virtual currencies. Again, this is completely indicative. It's more or less the feeling from the law enforcement perspective. Now to focus more on the virtual currency, there is definitely a big trend towards increasingly using cryptocurrencies, but we have limited evidence, I have to say. Well, we find that they're using virtual currencies mostly on the darknet, but also sometimes on the open web. Recently, we had an operation where we've seen that an open web, it was actually a hacked legitimate website that was providing child abuse material, they exclusively accepted Bitcoin payments. But again, I don't want to single out Bitcoin because they are using any virtual currencies, can be Litecoin, can be Dartcoin, you know, anything. Another example is that in 2013, during the takedown of Silk Road One, the illegal marketplace online that was distributing drugs and firearms and everything, we found, or investigators actually from the FBI found that there was a link to child abuse material in their blockchain related to Silk Road and the market share. So it's just an indication that they are using virtual currencies to distribute child abuse material. But again, those users, especially those on the darknet and that are interested in child abuse material, are very IT savvy, and they have a very good understanding that any use of payment methods is a vulnerability for them. It's a risk, so they will try to avoid that. And we're monitoring some discussion on the Tor network, for instance, where participants are discussing whether it's really worth trying to produce material for gains because they know that it's a trade-off with their security, and we're also witnessing discussions on, you know, alternative methods of trying to generate new materials. Well, just as a conclusion, I would say that we need to keep monitoring the new trends, that migrations from traditional payment methods towards new alternative payment methods. We need to work with all the stakeholders, and that's very, very important. We're setting the bar a bit higher every time to those offenders. We need to make it more difficult for them to distribute child abuse material. And I think I will conclude on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gregory. I think you made a very important point because you said, you mentioned the huge amount of images that we are talking about and the need to prioritize. And that also shows that we need these different strands of mechanisms and activities how to address the problem. It cannot go only via one way. And that's where the hotlines come into their role, because on the one hand, hotlines, when they discover material that is considered illegal, it goes straight forward to the law enforcement so that they can deal with that. But in the network, no gray areas, when the hotlines receive reports that they consider, even with national law in Germany, could not be considered illegal, then they turn to the companies like Google and still ask whether it's possible to remove the content. And I'm pretty sure that all the industry partners, they know about freedom of expression, and they will be very careful how they react to these reports. But when it comes to the trustful relationship within the network, you can be pretty sure that the hotlines have already assessed and considered whether they can turn to the provider asking for removal of the content. We have now another remote speaker, which is Akio Kokubu, and I hope that he is there. He has a big time difference coming from Japan, from the Japanese Internet Association, which is running a hotline as well. And Japan has already had an amendment to their legislation with regard to posing images. So, Akio, are you there? Yes, we can hear you. Wonderful. So, and we need the slides, please. Oh. Yes, the slides are here. You can just start, please. And very quickly. Please go ahead, Akio.
Yes, before I... albums are sold in stores and online. Depiction can be too provocative, such as sexually suggestive pose with partially closed or very small swim suit. They are illegal in Japan. If such photos correspond to child pornography law, Article 3, Number 3, as shown, still we don't have a slide in examples in the slide. 7 people who are selling preteen DVDs were arrested very recently on suspicion of distribution of child sexual abuse material. Can you show us the slide? Can you hear me?
Which slide do you mean? The role of internet hotlines. Can you go ahead, please?
Oh, yes. Although the police cracks down on child sexual abuse material thought as gray area, whether they are illegal or not is as the case may be. To improve such a situation, 11 organizations, including ECPAT Japan, the other child welfare organization called for changes to the child welfare law rather than child pornographic law in last month. Still, we don't have slide. I'm going to introduce the Internet Hotline Japan. Hotline has been operated under the contract with the National Police Agency since 2006. We receive reports anonymously from Internet users through a web form. and provide information to the National Police Agency. Also, we request deletion of illegal and harmful information from ISPs and website administrators. 17 analysts and 2 managers are currently working in the hotline. The number of reports from internet users is about 150,000 in 2014. Judgment for such a huge number of reports is a tough job for us.
Akio, we can hardly understand you. So if you don't mind, I would like you to come to the end of your presentation because it's very difficult for the audience to understand you.
Yes. Can you show us the slide?
I think we have the last slide now.
Last slide. Okay. This is the last slide. With illegal information received from internet users, hotline will generally carry out the following. Number one, inform police. Number two, submit notice and take down to website administrators and ISPs. Number three, inform related institutions. Number four, handle illegal information through international cooperation, such as INHOP. Context of information is confirmed by human eyes. In the past, I tried to develop an automatic content rating system on the internet with image recognition technologies. It was good for a screening tool, but confirmation by human eyes was still needed because such technology did not take into account context of information. This is the reason why we employ so many staff as analysts. Lastly, hotlines are primarily passive information. Namely, they do not search information by themselves to avoid criticism of censorship. Users' understanding for child sexual abuse material is necessary to receive such reports. Awareness activities to users are very important. Thank you very much for listening to my talk. Can you hear me?
And it will be commented on by Amy Crocker from the INHOP Foundation, who could explain a little bit more from the broad experience of more than 50 hotlines that are organized in INHOP.
Thank you very much. Just to clarify, I'll represent the INHOP Foundation, but also the INHOP Association, which is an international membership organization. So I should clarify that INHOP is not a hotline. But we have members in 45 countries, 51 members, who operate national services. And we've just had a very good presentation from one of our members in Japan. And I'm very happy to have two of our leading members in the room from the UK and Netherlands here. So if I say anything, they can tell me off. But you'd like me to speak to the role of hotlines in this area? Yes. I mean, again, because we're a membership organization, I have to make it clear that each hotline will operate under its own national legislation, and they will have processes in place to receive, analyze, and refer onwards child sexual abuse material for removal at source. And that means through the InHope network, using the international exchange platform that we have to ensure that a report of confirmed child sexual abuse material in the country that receives the report will be sent to the confirmed country where that material is being hosted for removal. In that country, and we operate a global mechanism that all our member hotlines have access to, and are cooperating on a daily basis to have that material removed. The role of hotlines in relation to material in the grey area is distinct from that of the role of InHope. We would defer to our national members would make a decision at their national level based on their legislation, based on the relationships they have with their industry and law enforcement about what they would do to potentially take action against material that is within the grey area. But I think definitions are important, and I do pick up on Natasha's point and I think Marco's point, and actually Gregory's point as well, about this idea of we need clear definitions and we need to be acting based on what is confirmed to be illegal in any particular country. That said, there are examples of Marco from Google also gave this example of companies that on a voluntary basis will be taking action against material that might be questionable, that might be concerning. But it's not the case that every single hotline would be able to do that or would have the capacity. And very much picking up on Gregory's point about being mindful of the law enforcement capacity to act, and we need to manage expectations in this area about what is possible. At the same time, we absolutely support an initiative that is trying to raise awareness and increase sensitize the general public to the nature of this material, and not just the material that is confirmed to be illegal, which will be the explicit sexual exploitation and abuse of a child, but also material that could be used for sexual purposes. That I hope gives us some kind of sort of insight into way that InHope sees this. And I would point out that with 45 countries in our network, there are countries where there is now legislation in place that will cover what is sometimes referred to as child modeling, sometimes referred to as child erotica. It will not be illegal in other countries. There's huge diversity in our network. One of the things that InHope is also doing with a new platform that we've developed over the last 2 years, which is primarily a content classification and hashing tool to provide information to law enforcement networks via Interpol, to provide information to victim identification law enforcement networks via Interpol. And one of the things that this tool is able to do is also create categories of information that are not illegal, that would be defined as not illegal by a hotline in their country, but nevertheless might be illegal in the country of hosting. So that there are things that can be done from the hotline perspective, but we have to be mindful that we have to defer to national legislations and national procedures on this issue. But from a child welfare perspective, absolutely, I think there's huge importance in making this issue of grey area material, putting it into the public debate.
For going a little bit more in. Thank you, Amy, for explaining a little bit more about the role of the InHope Association, the InHope Foundation, and what the single hotlines can do. And you've already referred to the role that child welfare organizations, child welfare advocates can play or have to play in that issue. And that's now the point of time to turn to ECPAT International as one of the most important players in that game. And Marie-Laure Lemineur will introduce you to a very recent activity that 35 child welfare organizations around the world have undertaken to put more focus on this issue and to broaden the focus of what we understand as unacceptable to be displayed on the internet. Please, Marie-Laure.
Thank you, Jutta. My name is Marie-Laure Lemineur. As Jutta said, I work for an organization called ECPA International. We are based in Thailand, and we are a network of 85 member organizations, AGOs, based in 77 countries. So my job today basically is to speak about a communique that has been issued by the network that Jutta mentioned, the network that on grey images that was launched in 2014, a little bit of background information. Then the network worked for a few months at a national level in Germany. Then in the context of the framework of the German G7 presidency, the network decided to organize a roundtable towards the end of October and recently. And the roundtable basically was aimed at discussing the issue around the grey images and also to adopt a communique. And basically, the aim of the communique is to declare to condemn all forms of sexual exploitation of children online, plus to declare a policy of zero tolerance towards exploitative images such as the grey images that are online. So basically, I believe you have the text of the communique somewhere. You should be able to see the slide. So I won't read it. It's quite boring. You can have a look yourself and ask questions whether about the content. It's divided into two sections. The first one is a brief introduction, definitions, and then you have the postulations. The communique has been signed so far by, endorsed by 34 organizations. It's still open for endorsement, so whoever is here representing an organization and is interested in joining in, please do approach Jutta and her team and to discuss it. Has been endorsed by several national and international organizations, such as ECPAC Germany, Sweden, the Canadian Center for Child Protection, Child Focus, European NGO Alliance for Child Safety Online. And speaking of the next steps, the idea is to issue officially the communique on November 18th, which is the European, it's a new European day. It's a new European day on the protection of children against sexual exploitation and abuse. So that would be the day that the communique would be officially launched. That would be it. Thank you so much.
Due to the technical problems, we have been running out a little bit of time, but I think there is still room for two or three questions. If there are any people in the room who are interested in the work that the network has already been doing, how the network, the idea of the network can be transferred to other countries, how you would like to take up on the idea, how it can be supported by technology. So please feel free to come over to the micro and put your questions to the panelists and the speakers. Yes, please.
Hi, thank you for this presentation. My name is Mariel Garcia. I'm an activist from Mexico, and I'm part of the Youth at IGF program. And one of the concerns that we as youth have is that in this fight against child exploitation, many times teens are criminalized because they are sharing images that end up through these filters, or this legislation that is used to attack something horrible is also used to attack and criminalize teenagers. And so I wanted to know what, in your experience, what speech you have encountered or what actions have you taken to prevent this abuse of a super good effort to criminalize teenagers. Thank you.
Yes, there is a workshop this afternoon about youth self-produced content that would address specifically this issue. So I would invite you to join in. I don't remember room. It's at 4 p.m., but I don't remember the room, but you can look on the schedule.
I just want to add that if you have a look at the communique, you will find that we explicitly not have been talking about self-produced content in the communique, because we, in the communique, we want to address the responsibility of the other stakeholders that are involved in that, and we did not want to put responsibility on youth that have produced images themselves, although we know that self-produced images somehow can go also in that abusive area. They can be exploitative, but it's not, it should not be the sole responsibility of the youth. So it's not the attempt of criminalizing youth, it's the attempt of having the other stakeholders involved. I think we have a remote participant, and then we have Patrick Curry as another questioner.
Gitte Jakobsen wants to comment on that question. Yeah. Please, Gitte.
I need to leave for another meeting, but if there are any pressing questions for me, I'm happy to answer.
This great area is not about the self-exposition material, although it could be, but that is not the issue. When you look at the images I showed to you, you know exactly the difference between the exploitation of the children for someone else's purpose. Actually, I wanted to address, that's why I raised my hand, address Gregory's presentation. Thank you. I really like that also from the enforcement perspective. I agree with you that it's a matter of police priority if gray area should be a top or not. But fact is, from our experience, that some of the gray area images actually gives, could be the last missing piece in the big jigsaw puzzle you need to engage in the final investigation of perpetrators, because sometimes we see gray area images hold an even more information to give the identification of victims and places and perpetrators, because they seem to be less careful of what they put in images that are not completely illegal. So for that reason, to have gray area images also included in what is illegal makes it possible to enter data into the databases for legal for the LEA and also into Europol Interpol databases that we also type data into from the InHope network. Thank you
for that explanation, and I see some kind of confirmation from law enforcement from my left side. Would you add something, and then we take another question?
No, I don't really have anything to add. I agree with you, Gita, and even I would say that the grey images also sometimes serve just to lure or bring the offenders to another hidden website behind where you find much more horrific. So yeah, it is very, very important from an investigation perspective, because as you say, they give more evidence.
Thank you. My name is Patrick Curry. I'm from an organization called BBFA. And I'd like to make a point, first of all. The requirements to be able to identify, detect, prevent these different kinds of mechanisms that we're talking about here, many of these are already advancing in other related areas. And so I would make a plea for coordination, greater cooperation and coordination on these cross-cutting activities. I'm also here on behalf of EU Project Mapping, which includes Interpol, and we've had exactly this discussion in Interpol about how we can reuse capabilities and techniques. We are seeing governments that are looking for more regulation, particularly the United Kingdom, for age verification, for online access to adult content, as it's called. 7.5 million foreign websites that we know about. How the United Kingdom is going to enforce some kind of legislation for age verification for that, none of us really know at the moment. But I would suggest that there is a lot of crossover that can take place here. And I'm particularly looking at some of the advances in blockchain technologies to try and get assurance and also in identity management. And some of the more advanced video, we haven't mentioned video, but in the adult world, the amount of content generation today is moving from images, the balance is moving from images to video, because you can. And so that presents significant additional challenges in that area. So I realize we're running out of time, but I'd like to make a plea for greater cooperation, and I would be very happy to discuss in detail what that means. And the second point, my question is, how important is video to you?
As I'm not representing a hotline and I've never analyzed the content, I cannot answer that question completely. What we know is that there is evidence, like for so-called child pornography, that we have also embedded gray area imagery in video material, but we can't tell to what extent. Has anybody else on the panel some experience?
Video is important because we recognize, and I totally acknowledge your point, and the hotlines see, and we have hotlines in the room, but there's been and I've also worked with law enforcement, there's been a huge migration, there's an increase in video because of, greater storage capacity, better broadband speeds, all of these things. And it's very important, and there are several ongoing efforts. Google, who have left the room, are currently developing, I think they're even testing now their video technology. The tool that I just mentioned that InHope has developed in the last 2 years uses a video hashing solution in order to be able to actually process videos and provide that information to Interpol, to law enforcement. So absolutely, it's important. And I think you would also agree with me that no one's yet solve that problem, but there's a lot going on in that space because we have to respond to the reality of what we see around us, and this is not speaking to grey area material. This is speaking about the problem in general. So I would like to get an answer on that content based, Marilou.
To add just very briefly, I think it's very clear to all of us in the community who are trying to deal with combating sexual exploitation online that we speak about child abuse images. We cover stilled images of moving materials. I mean, it's, and we're also very aware that the share of videos is growing among the collections, and based on the reports from law enforcement, but you obviously aware of it, of that.
Okay, we have one brief comment from Gitte Jacobsen from Denmark.
Of the gray area material. And then there is the new aspect of this whole field that sex tourism no longer requires you to travel, because there's a lot of digital or video sexual abuse going on in the illegal part of it, but certainly also in the gray area, because for some that's what they want. So video is definitely also on the table for this part.
Thank you, Gigi, once again for stepping in. I think we have one last question.
Thank you. My name is Arsène Tungali. I'm from the Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm an ISOC ambassador for the IGF this year. I don't have any question, but it will be probably a comment, because the issues of sexual abuse for children online, as we see it in developed countries, are very different from the way we see child online protection in developing countries, if we can say it like that. The issues of hotlines, I would like to say, for instance, in countries like mine, there is no hotlines that can support children, to report those cases of violation. I would like to know if there is one or any of your organizations working to support African countries, for instance, or other less developed countries in order to deal with those issues of child online protection. Thank you.
Yes, just on the GSMA's activities, we've been focusing a lot on Africa recently, providing capacity building in the area of children and mobile phones. So not just around child sexual abuse content and exploitation, but also about children's safe and responsible use of the internet. We've also participate in multi-stakeholder workshops with some of the participants who are in that room, so that we can start getting the understanding of some of these issues and some of the best practices or examples from around the world, so that the African countries can deal with it swifter than perhaps we have previously.
And just in relation to your point about hotlines and helplines, and sometimes there's confusion with the terminology, but I absolutely agree with your point. And actually, one of the things that InHope is doing through the foundation, the InHope Foundation, is trying to support startup initiatives that would like to establish exactly that kind of national reporting mechanism in their countries. And the Internet Watch Foundation, who are also in the room, also have a solution, and they work very much internationally to try and support countries to do a similar thing. So, you know, feel free to speak to either InHope or the Internet Watch Foundation, and I can give you more information. It is a challenge. And I would also say that I haven't been to your country, but I agree there are very different challenges in different countries. But I think what we also see and have seen is that as internet connectivity increases, as there's more access, there are more opportunities for the exploitation of children, and there are similarities in the way that children can be reached and then exploited on online. So in that sense, you know, we can have some common solutions, and certainly from a technological point of view, you know, the solutions can be very similar. And yes, we've been working very closely with GSMA, and they're doing great work in on the continent to try and support activities in this area. So.
Yes, yeah, so I think it's time to conclude the session, and I would like to make use of that opportunity to come back to the question that was raised regards freedom of expression. Those of you who have been looking into the program for the Internet Governance Forum might have seen that this workshop was categorized under the sub-theme of human rights, and that was not done only on occasion but by purpose, because we think it's very important to talk about the human rights of children and to ask the question whether the protection of the dignity and privacy and physical integrity of children can be balanced with the right to freedom of expression. And that is one of the questions that we will bring forward from this workshop to the main session on human rights, which will be held on Friday morning, I think at 11 o'clock. So please feel free to come to the main session on human rights as well, where we can continue the discussion about the balance between freedom of expression and human rights. It's time to thank all of you for being so patient, for staying so long with us for the debate, and it's time to thank all the speakers. Unfortunately, Marco Pancini had already to leave. If some of you has questions to Marco Pancini, you can come right to me and I will pass them forward to Marco. He will answer them afterwards. Last comment, the workshop that was mentioned on self-produced content is in workshop room 3 at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and maybe we will see some of you there. Feel free to come with your questions to us. We will be outside right now for the coffee break, and enjoy the break and your stay at João Pessoa. Thank you.